Hello and welcome back to the Angry Dave podcast. My next guests are returning. We got Mark Flocco, and we got John Gannone, Sylvester Gannone.
Indiana Gannone.
Indiana Gannone. Say hello, fellas, Frank.
What's up, everybody?
Hello, everyone. It's John.
All right, so this podcast is really directed towards Mark more than John, but I'm sure John's going to have plenty to say.
That's sad.
We had a few drinks before we came here. We tried not to get as drunk as the last time.
Speaking of. What do we have here?
John's going to go grab some beers so we can get started right. All right, so Mark, talk to me about, give me your background. Introduce yourself to everybody. You were born and raised in South Philly, correct?
Correct, I was.
And you are how old?
I'm 52, 1971. Was born and raised in South Philly. Was here through my college years before I ventured off and did some stuff, but for the most part, here in South Philly.
And how about your background, your family background?
Family grew up with 2,500 mole. Mom, dad, older brother, younger brother. I'm a middle child and a Gemini, so I was doomed from the start. And we grew up on mole, went to St. Monica's, grade school.
Yeah.
Went to Bishop Newman, just, you know. The
South Philly way.
The norm for the South Philly way, yeah.
Yeah. And what were you like as like a grade schooler, middle schooler?
I was a late bloomer. I was such a nerd as a kid. I didn't bloom until later in life, probably not until I got in high school.
Yeah. Any crazy stories from like early childhood, anything like that? Any crazy memories?
No, early child. I was the teacher's pet. I was a nerd. I was a kiss ass.
Really?
Good grades. Always finished top of the class. Yeah. I didn't bloom until high school.
All right.
So, not like a nerd.
So what would your parents said about you? Just a good kid as a young kid?
I think so, yeah. I was always like the perfect attendance. Like, don't know why I was in the school. I hated it, but yet I went every day and excelled at it and did well.
And then you got to high school at Newman?
Got to high school at Newman, and then I realized how lax you can be and how you can get away with still doing it and have some fun. And,
right.
And that's where I think I started to fail in life.
So talk to me about those years. What was Mark like at that time?
I want to say very shy and timid freshman year. I was always a little petite, scrawny.
Yeah.
Little guy, and then started doing the Wildwood thing, and I started hitting the Attila's gym, and I, you know, grew into my body, and started getting a little built, and then got a little more confident in life, and then, you know, just became a maniac.
When did the girls come?
Girls come probably, I would say, end of freshman year and a sophomore year is when I, you know, started to get into that and realize, ooh, this is fun.
Yeah.
That's so old.
Yeah, well, you know, we all can't be Mr. Shamwell, so.
Shamwell. We'll talk about the Shamwell later. What do your parents and your siblings say about you, Mark, in high school?
I think my parents were always proud of me, grades per se, never really got in trouble, never had cops at the house or teachers complaining, but, I think my older brother got the brunt of everything because he was the oldest, and then... As you go down the line, it gets a little bit easier. And then my younger brother got away with everything because that's just the way it works. But I always felt bad for my mother for having three boys.
Right.
And God bless her for putting up with it. But I think it got a little easier as it went down the line.
When did you meet Mr. Sylvester Gannone?
Johnny actually was friends with my younger brother, Mike.
Yeah.
We met in, I would say I was probably junior. Senior, yeah. So he hung around. We had a clubhouse up Percy Street.
Still do.
30-something years. And all the guys, I had a really tight niche group of friends growing up, and we always all hung out, and we all had younger brothers, so we took them and their friends in, and we all just kind of hung out together, but I always had a kinship with John, and we just always naturally got along, and I'd like to think that we actually became better friends than him and my brother.
Yeah.
And then from there, it got damn ugly.
any crazy stories from high school
that you
can think of?
I'm sure. We, going back to the Percy Street days up our clubhouse, we were absolute maniacs. I mean, this place was like a frat house in the middle of an industrial street.
Right.
And we would just have parties and did whatever, and no one ever bothered us up the street. I mean, I'll give you an example. One time we had a, the guy that owned the building had a garage downstairs, and he feuded with the garage at the corner, and they parked a giant tractor trailer up Percy Street. So our landlord, as much as he didn't want us doing bad things, was mad at the guy for doing this. So we took it upon ourselves. That's our landlord. That's our guy. He helps us out, and we just we basically lit it on fire, and we got rid of it for him. And you know, he knew we did it, but.
But there was also another time where there was a car that was abandoned on the street for weeks and weeks and weeks. And we thought we were doing a favor. So one night we come home drunk and we destroy this car.
From a wedding, no less. We're in suits.
We're in suits.
And how old were you guys?
I'm probably 21.
Okay.
I'm going to be 50 now. So.
Right. Yeah, no, it's that statute of limitations is over. You're good.
No, it's never over in my life. Trust me. They find me. Yeah. We destroy this car. Flip it over.
I mean, we come home from this wedding in suits like maniacs. And we literally get out of the car. We don't even go inside. We just instantly jump on top of the car.
Kicking the windows in.
Grabbing barbells, just jumping up and down the car.
Yeah.
Dancing, singing songs, and destroy. Like, this car was flat. It looked like a compactor hit it from the junkyard. And, you know, this is a Saturday night. So Monday we're at the club, and we see the guy downstairs, and he's like, hey, did you guys do anything in that car? We're sitting outside, and we're like, nah, what are you talking about? We didn't touch that. He's like, that was a customer's car.
Oh, my God.
I mean, he knew instantly. He saw the looks on our face. We're like, oh, shit. Where were we on that one, dipshit?
All right, so what did you do? What did you do after high school, Ray? Did you go to college?
I did. I went to Drexel, commuted to Drexel. School was not my strong point, but my pop was a union guy, and I would have loved to have done that, but he wanted better things, and I didn't like school. Yeah. And I went, and I made it. I passed. I got a degree from Drexel, but it was not fun. I was never really
into it.
The school person, yeah. I did play college hockey, and I enjoyed the shit out of that. That was fun. That was probably the highlight of me going to college.
Did you make a lot of friends at college, or how did that go?
I wanted to. But we kind of like commuted with South Philly people.
Right.
So the first day when we walked into class, people's shoulders instantly dropped. They're like, oh, it's these dickheads.
Yeah.
You know, so it was tough. I mean, I was able to venture out and make some friends, especially from playing hockey. And a lot of the guys that played hockey were in a frat house, and I became friendly with a lot of those people. So I was, but it was tough. It was tough. Everybody associated me with the gang that we hung out with and commuted with. So
the South Philly people.
Yeah.
So,
I don't blame them. No.
Right. What were you like at that time? Were you out of your shell?
Definitely. Yeah. I mean, I don't know. The guys that we commuted with, we were just main. I mean, half the time we didn't go to class. We're in the student center playing pinochle and, torturing teachers and torturing food truck guys and just like, everybody on campus knew who we were. Luckily, I was smart enough to get through and have good grades. So they're like, all right, he's not a total asshole. But, people definitely shunned us and looked at us in a different way.
How about hockey? Talk to me about that experience.
Hockey is again, John.
Yeah.
I went to see Mark play once.
Yeah.
In Drexel, excuse me. One time I go to see him. He's playing. And it was a line to get in the place. So we get in there a few minutes late. he's already kicked out of the game for fighting. he comes up dressed in street clothes. What's going on? I'm like, what are you doing? We came to see you. Oh, I got kicked out. I got to fight.
Well, that's what happens. It was like when the puck dropped. No, I have it quite a few times. I'd like to think I was a decent hockey player, but I had a rep and a role to play on the team, and I was an agitator, and you know,
you were a goon.
No, I'm not. Obviously, at 5'8", a buck fucking 60, you're no goon, but. I had a role to play, and I was an agitator and an instigator. And
I
did what I had to do. And
Matthew Barnaby,
to an extent, yeah, to an extent.
Not Craig Berube.
No, by no means.
So I don't know if you know this, but we did a podcast with Frankie and Gianzano. I've been doing a sports podcast. Craig Berube has one of the like eighth most penalty minutes of all time. And he has the least amount of points out of anybody who's ever played 1,000 games.
Really?
Okay. Literally the quintessential goon.
Good.
Anyway,
get him. But he wasn't. He wasn't actually a bad player. He did have some skills.
He did have some skills.
No, I had some skills. I got my share of points, but I was a third line center. We were that defensive line. They're like, yo, this is the guy. Break his balls. And
right.
I would just ride him and put my stick and try to draw penalties and get under their skin. And if I could get him out of the game, I was doing my job. So
right.
that's kind of the role I played there.
Nice.
And there were a lot of games where family and friends came, and I was in the stands already showered by the time they got there.
back then you didn't get, like, suspended for a period of time for fighting?
Well, a fight instantly got you out of the game.
Right.
You're automatically out of game, and I think that if it was ongoing, you would get suspensions down the line. So I would pick my moments, but it was so – Penn was our – University of Penn was our home rink.
Okay.
When I played for Drex, and we would get a couple thousand people. It was so much fun. I mean,
really?
At that age, just playing in front of people just made your adrenaline go. It was so much fun.
Just the cheering, right?
And, you know, you're picking on this guy, and the crowd's going crazy. You're like, yeah, I'm going to fuck him up.
Yeah. Yeah.
I can't let these people down.
That's awesome.
It was fun.
So what did you do? You finished college in 4 years?
Drexel had a five-year program
because
they did a co-op thing. So the middle 3 years, you go to school for half a year, you work for half a year. So it was the John Belushi program of college.
But what did you major in?
I was a marketing major, business degree.
All right, so you finished college in 5 years.
Yes.
That makes you a graduate in
94.
Okay. Yeah. When I was graduating high school.
He was graduating.
You old fuck.
It's going to be a job for anything with his degree.
Well, I know.
Are you hiring, Dave?
The funniest part was, he started plumbing with me right when after he got done graduating.
Is that what you did?
Oh, my God. Yeah. When I got out of college, I struggled. I worked for electricians, I worked for plumbers. I did everything.
But he always wanted to do that work. Like, Mark was a hands-on kind of thing. Like, he wanted to.
Right.
Well, my dad was a steam fitter. He was a union guy, and he always did it. And I idolized him for that. The guy went to work, fed his family. And there's something about
paid for hard, their college.
Yes.
But he really wanted you to go to college.
He did. And that was never my mind. I wanted to be a fireman, be honest with you. And they wouldn't let me.
Really?
I mean, if there was one thing in life that I actually wanted to do, I wanted to do that. And he's like, absolutely not.
And do you regret, like, do you feel like it was a waste of time other than the hockey, I guess?
Yeah, I do. And I still have regrets to my dad for what he went through and all the money that he spent. It wasn't me. I didn't want to do that.
You know,
but I felt obligated to because he did what he did. And I went through and I made it through, but I did have a so-called job in my field for a good while that I did enjoy.
Yeah.
But I guess we'll get to that later. I'm sure you have
a
thousand questions.
It's all right. But, no, so, I was just, this is a one-off, but I've been trying to, like, my son wants to do, like, film and stuff like that. And
awesome.
But he also thinks that he needs to go to college. And, you know, like, I have a law degree, right? So I went to a lot of college.
Right.
And his mother has a graduate degree, so she went to a lot of college. So I feel like he feels some kind of pressure to get a
bring him down here. I'll talk to him. I know guys and were bookies and cut hair till they were 40, and then they became millionaires.
Right. It doesn't matter.
You don't need school. It's to me, education is one of the biggest ripoffs in this country.
I mean, you do need it for certain things, right? You need it.
Sometimes you need that piece of paper to get your foot in the door. But
right. If you want to be a lawyer, you obviously.
But if you're driven and you got goals, you do whatever you want to do. You don't need that piece of paper. I think that's a bunch of bullshit.
No, I agree with you. And I think our generation really got fucking duped by the fact that you needed a law degree. I mean, or you needed a degree.
A degree, sure.
Right, so, you know, like I graduated with a 4-year degree, and then I was like, well, what the fuck am I going to do?
I think my degree is useless. I mean, yeah. you're talking 96 or 94, I graduate, right?
Yeah.
Internet was just coming out in 96.
Yeah, right.
So now I had jobs and I did things. Now I'm 52 and I'm a bartender. If I wanted to go back into marketing, I can't. It's a totally different thing right now. I would have to go back to school again and do it all over.
Yeah,
it's a different time. It's a different age. It's just, it won't work.
John, you were going to say something?
I forgot what it was.
Have another shot, buddy.
Do we have shots?
I think we do somewhere.
Do we have any Jameson left from last time?
Somewhere. It's somewhere in this fucking house somewhere. Anyway. All right, so you leave school and then you start doing what, odd jobs?
Yeah, odds and ends, plumbing,
yeah,
electrician.
I remember what it was.
Yeah. Oh, you got it?
Go for it.
No, that I went into plumbing after I tried college for one semester.
Yeah.
And I'm so thankful, because I wasn't a school person either,
right,
that I don't have college debt.
Yeah.
You know, because I would have done it just to go through the motions and everything. And I didn't know at the time what I wanted to do, but I learned a trade after that. And I went from, I started making good money immediately.
Right.
You know, I was 19.
Making
a couple hundred dollars a week.
Yeah.
You know, and then I didn't have, you know, I see my fiance, she hundreds of thousands of dollars that she, you know, had to pay.
Dude, I'm still paying
it
back.
She's got a doctorate.
Yeah, I don't know how people do it. I mean, it's just.
Well, I said to my son, too, is, you know, he wanted to go to, NYU, which is a great school. And if you can get some scholarships, fantastic, go there. But if you're going to go to NYU, you know, I said I graduated with a law degree in 2002. I have a car payment for 30 years. I said, at this time, you're going to graduate from NYU. If you don't have any, you know, if you don't have any help, right, you're going to graduate and you're going to have a fucking mortgage for 30 years.
Yeah. Yeah, it's disgusting.
It's a 30-year mortgage.
It's disgusting. That's what I said. I look at it now and I'm... I want to say when I went to Drexel in 89, it might have been 12 grand a year.
Yeah.
For 5 years, you're talking 60.
And that was expensive.
60 grand, which was expensive. Now it's 60 grand a year.
Yes, if not more.
Yeah. I mean, I was always grateful for my dad that he did that. I ate that. I didn't have any school debt.
It's amazing, yeah.
But yeah, I do have regrets for that poor man fucking working so hard and doing that. And I'm bartending now, so...
Community college, my freshman year, first semester was, I went full time. It was $1,900.
$1,900.
For my classes.
Yeah. I mean, I went to Westchester.
My books cost that much.
I went to Westchester.
They did. Their books were close to that much.
Yeah.
Which I sold back. And
you went to Westchester? Parents.
Yeah, no, it's fucking John's just going to keep talking. He's not even saying anything.
That's what he's got diarrhea in the mouth. It's okay.
I went to Westchester in 94. It was $8,500 a year to live on campus.
Really? Wow, I know. It just goes to show you how.
It's so much different now. All right, so you said you had a job in marketing at some point.
Yeah, so in 96, I scored a job for a company they were an independent contractor for setting up trade show exhibits.
Oh, okay.
And their main office was in Atlanta, Georgia.
Yeah.
And I was tired of South Philly and
yeah,
shit being the way it was, and I'm like, fuck it, I'm going.
Yeah.
And I did. I up and went by myself, and I moved to Atlanta for this job.
Right.
And I was there for 2 years. And I did love the job. I loved the industry. I loved the job. I was good at it. Just office politics and corporate bullshit.
Yeah.
It just deterred me from doing it.
Yeah. What about the office politics was the worst? Is just having to kiss ass?
Just you're salary based.
Yeah.
Which means they're already taking advantage of you. I'm babysitting kids. I'm driving Nautilus machines across state lines. You know, I'm a West Coast manager, so now I'm getting calls at 11 o'clock at night. And people in the city, who locked their keys in the car? Can you bring this spare? So I'm just doing everything. I'm the new guy. I'm trying to make money. I'll do whatever I got to do.
Yeah.
to be this. But yeah, they take advantage of you, and you know, now they're nitpicking at shit. Like I was 96. I was what, 25? Okay.
1,000 times late.
Had a hard time getting to work on time.
You had a little bit of a tardy problem.
Yes, I did. I was never a morning person ever in my life. And you know, I'm not gonna lie. Yeah. I'm not worried. I'm showing up the late 5-10 minutes work every fucking day. I'm fucking late. Now I'm dating myself. We have pagers.
Pagers.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I'm an accounts manager for a salesman who's one of the biggest salesmen in the industry.
Right.
And I'm like, okay, I'm late. I'm like, did any one of your clients ever not get a call back? I have this pager. I do my job. I'm also the guy that's there till 8 o'clock at night while you people left at 5.
Right.
And you're going to nitpick and break my balls about 5 minutes in the morning. You know I'm 25. I'm out having fun. I'm still here. I'm still doing my job.
Right.
And are they wrong? No. But,
yeah, but
like there's a give and take there where like, yo, guy's doing his job. He's handling millions of dollars worth of accounts and makes minimal mistakes and it's getting done.
Right.
Now my boss, God bless him, he earned his time. He's not in the office. He's golfing. He's at the gym. He's doing whatever. I got you, dude. It's all cool. But now you're gonna break my balls about 5 fucking minutes? I have a problem with that.
Yeah.
And that built up resentment and issues, and eventually they wanted to fire me. But they're not totally wrong, but I think they were wrong. I'm like, you have to look at things at the whole.
Well, the big picture, right? The big picture, what's important. But just a...
And that could be my opinion. Maybe I just look at things that way, but...
No, I hear you. I feel the same way. I used to have this problem in a lot of the law firms that I worked at where, like, FaceTime meant something, right? So, you know, you didn't necessarily have to be in at 9 o'clock or 8:30 every day. But if they didn't see you in the office, it was like you didn't exist and you weren't actually working.
Well, their big thing they would come at me all the time is, well, it's... perceptions. That's how people see you. Uh-huh. And if they see you coming to the office, I'm like, our office has 5 fucking people in it that I'm all best friends with.
Yeah.
They know me.
I want to. Yeah. They know I'm late.
Yeah. And they know how I work. They know what I do. I help every one of them when they need fucking help. Yeah. And they do the same for me. Like, it's a give and take.
I once got a knock on my door early in my law career.
Can you sense the bitterness?
Yeah. No. I hate it too, man. I can't stand that like results mean less than perception or whatever, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And they know it, like they always knew what I was doing too. I was billing hours, their clients loved me, but I wasn't, you know, I fucking went home after the afternoon hearing at 3:30. I just drove to fucking Scranton and back. Yeah, I went home early today.
Yeah.
But I'm gonna work fucking 12 hours tomorrow. Like, leave me the fuck alone. I'm getting the job done.
It's a give and take, and you hate when people nitpick about stupid shit.
But just to plug episode 10 of this podcast, you can learn about some stories that John Gannone had when he went to live with Flocco.
Oh, he did come and meet me in Atlanta. Yeah, I got him.
I got him.
I got him for a total of 6 months. He lasted. Yeah.
Then he just kind of left.
I was. Here's a funny story, real quick, before you get to Gannone. I was in Atlanta for the '96 Olympics, and I was accused of being the pipe bomber. My friends know me and how bitter and angry I am, and when the bomb did go off, they for a split second they thought it was me.
Your friends.
Yeah, my friends, not the cops, my friends.
John, is that true?
Absolutely.
All right, so you come back to Philly in what year? 97.
I got one more Atlanta story back to Philly. Absolutely. True story. Obviously, you remember Bronx Tale.
I do.
The Mush Man.
Yeah.
All right. Well, growing up, I was our Mush Man. So I'm living in Atlanta, and believe me, when I lived in Atlanta, I tried. I tried so hard to be a Braves fan. It just was not going to happen.
Right.
Like, I went to games. I tried. Like, the Atlanta hat didn't work. So I believe it's 96? 96 or 97? Might have been 96. Atlanta Yankees World Series.
Yeah.
Atlanta wins the first two in New York.
Right.
They're up 2-0. They all call me. They're like, you got to do something, dude. We can't have Atlanta winning the World Series. I'm like, oh, what do you want me to do? I'm like, all right, I got it. I'll take care of it. I'm going to say it was like a Wednesday night. I get my car. I was 25 minutes outside of the city. I get my car, drive down to the stadium, and I circled it like five or six times. And Atlanta didn't win another game. So, you know, they owe me.
Derek Jeter owes you, I think.
He might. He's got the money. He owes me.
All right, so you come back to Philly, and then what do you do then?
I come back to Philly, and funny story, I remember before I even moved back, I come back. I think it was one of our friends' weddings, and I'm in town. And I tell this nutball that I'm coming home, and he gets so excited that he runs his head through a piece of sheetrock and gets it stuck in between the two studs.
It was like the ball
from the Billy D. Williams. No, it literally gets his head stuck in between two studs, like where we had it.
Right through a wall, and I couldn't get it back out.
So, you know, I mean, that made me feel great.
My
buddy's excited that I'm coming up.
And he gave himself a concussion.
Yeah, me not so much.
Well, you can't hurt that head. But, yeah, no, I came home, and I was still with the company, and a position opened up in our Jersey office, and he knew I was from here, and I was down there like a deer in the headlights by myself, and they said, you know, that's there if you want it. And I was like, yeah, shit, yeah. Well, I'm ready to go home. I've been here for 2 years.
Right. And you were ready?
I was ready.
Did you miss it?
I miss my people.
Yeah.
Did I miss the city per se? I don't know.
Right.
I just, like I said, we had such a group of great guys and good friends that, I miss that.
You miss your friends, yeah.
Yeah.
All right, so you get back here and you're working there for a little bit, then you get fired? Or
yeah, well... And then here's a little more to politics. I know I'm talking like a bitch. I'm fucking drunk.
That's all right. No, go for it.
But the guy that I was talking about was a salesman.
Yeah.
When they moved me to Jersey,
it was
their decision, not his. So their resentment started from there. He was a chauvinist. He wanted a girl with tits to fucking work for him.
Yeah.
And then that's where the resentment started, and then every little thing I did wrong got nitpicked.
No, he doesn't.
Because he didn't want me.
He doesn't like throw up and do six packs.
No, he actually went to the gym to get a six pack.
We're not talking about six pack of beer, kids. So,
Shamwell,
what did you do after that job?
Shit, we came back 96. What did I do? Well, I came home. Oh, it was more odds and ends.
Yeah,
I started doing a few jobs here and there. Then I wound up latching on to another buddy of ours who owned a scrapyard.
Okay.
Oh, wow. Missed that whole era.
What's that?
Buddy of mine had a printing company
called
Image Graphics, and I worked with them as a salesman for a while.
Okay.
I would say it was a couple of years. They started off nice, and things were well there for a while, but I think that was right around 9/11, so that kind of
tailed off.
Tailed off, put a damper on. The club scene was big then. They had a lot of their business was doing flyers and printouts for the club scene.
So that's kind of marketing too, really.
Yeah. Right? Yeah.
Except he was the guy cutting the flyers back then.
That's all right.
I did everything. I'm willing to go to the extra mile, man.
That's right.
He really did. I did the printing. I did the cutting. I did the selling. I did whatever.
I'll fucking train you. Trash can, you know what I'm saying? He's not afraid of it.
I'm a company guy. I'll do whatever you need until you piss me off.
Until you tell him you have to be in him by 9.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
Fuck you guys.
Thanks, buddy. Why couldn't you be my agent?
He was working on, if you ever seen like Catch Me If You Can, the thing, it's called a Heidelberg.
Yeah.
He was working on a Heidelberg machine. Doing
we had a
Heidelberg because they did the printing with the ink printing and all.
Yeah.
Then he had the machine like that would industrially cut. Johnny, like stuff like that.
Yeah,
he would actually hemmed all his pants. By the way, in the 90s, it was perfect too because it was.
It's not my fault. I'm short, man. Come on.
Yeah, you can have the fray at the bottom, but he would take his pants off and put them in the machine and cut his pants.
When did you start bartending?
That didn't happen. Yeah, that was much later. After the Image Graphics, I hooked up with another friend who had a family run scrapyard, and I ran machinery for probably about a decade.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Like what kind of like you? Like you fucking crushing cars and shit?
No, they had them.
John's laughing. I don't know what the fuck that's about.
Yeah, he's off on his own.
I'm bitching him. He worked at a scrapyard. He was like scrap metal and shit. He was like Sanford.
Basically, I ran the machine. So in other words, you brought all your copper wire in.
Yeah.
And I took it and I put it on the machine.
Yeah.
And it broke it down in little pieces.
Yeah.
And then I took it and I took it to another machine that shredded it down even more. And then it went on a table with air and vibration that separated the copper from the trash, and it would come out pure copper.
Awesome, yeah.
And it was pretty exciting, but grueling.
Your lung doesn't think so.
Yeah, yeah. It's still here.
So you clearly like to work with your hands. Like, that's something...
I do. I always did, yeah.
What is it about it that makes you like it?
There's a gratification to it. Like, you feel like you're accomplishing something. Like, I could talk to you on the phone and be like, hey, buy our product, this is this. And then I feel like I'm just a bullshitter. But when you work with your hands, you feel like you're actually accomplishing something.
Yeah. You get a finished product. Yeah.
Yeah, there's some gratification to that.
All right, so after the scrapyard, you do what?
That's when I got into bartending.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
And how long has that been? How many years?
I've been bartending for probably about 15 years, yeah, at least.
All right, I need three bartending stories.
Three?
Three.
Do they have to be fun ones?
They can.
They should be.
You can.
They should be, right?
Don't get shit off your chest right now.
No. So they can be fun, but I do want to get the angry troll out of you, because it's going to be a future part of the future of this podcast is going to be angry part of Mark.
I will say one of my most monumental stories behind a bar.
Yeah.
Was back when I was still in high school.
Okay.
And I was a bar. I was a cook.
Okay.
At Covadas in Wildwood.
Yeah.
And this melee broke out that when I tell you was something out of a movie. Thank God I was upstairs. I had like the cutout. So like the overhang looked over the main dance floor.
Yeah, yeah.
When I tell you everybody in the place was fighting, it looked like bonanza. It looked like a West. I mean, people were throwing chairs, cash registers. Like, the bartenders ducked behind the bar. Like, everybody in the place was fighting.
Really?
I don't know how it happened, how it started.
It's like the Kingsman scene.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it was insane. Like, it was probably one of the most insane things I've ever seen in my life.
And how old were you, like, 16?
I was, like, 18, 19.
And what did you do? Just
I hid. I'm not dumb. I was like...
How about an angry bartender story?
Angry bartender story. Don't think I ever put hands on anybody, but I have a cunning way with words and you make people feel like shit. I had a guy, actually it wasn't too long ago, he's a bad drunk, and he accused me
of
taking his keys. And he kept insisting. Sorry. I said, I did not take your keys. He's like, yes, you did. There's my keys right there. I can see them behind the bar. I'm like, I did not take your keys. And he kept insisting. I want to say it's a good 20 minutes. And finally, I grabbed the keys, which were my keys that I leave behind the bar when I come in, and I slapped the right hand. I'm like, I did not take your fucking keys. These are my keys, you jerk off. Still didn't believe me until another customer went to him. He's like, you got a bulge in your pocket. You sure your keys aren't in your pocket? Sure enough, his keys were in his own pocket.
Did he apologize?
Well, he didn't come back for a couple of weeks. He that was his apology.
Yeah,
He knew he did wrong.
All right, how about a? you've had a have a lot of bartenders where people just fucking annoy the fuck out of you.
Yeah, I mean it's part of territory. I mean nobody's. I mean even myself included. When I'm on the other side of the bar, I know I can be annoying. When you're drinking, it's a different. Hanging on his lap. I'm fun annoying, right, John?
Not you. I was thinking of myself. Like, I'm never annoying.
Never. No.
I'm never.
Oh, the one time we had an eating contest at the bocce.
Yeah.
And I'm working, and we didn't. It was the night. It was the Friday night before the Wing Bowl, before the Super Bowl. We did like our own kind of Wing Bowl thing, but we didn't do wings. We did pasta.
Yeah.
So this one guy's gassed up animal. I don't know how many perks he snorted or whatever he did, but he's literally like hand shoving pasta in his mouth. He starts choking. I mean, he's purple. Purple. They cannot. And the guy's so big, they can't get around him for the Heimlich. They're trying. They're banging him against chairs. Nothing. I think finally somebody had to actually put their hand down his throat and pull out the piece of pasta. He was purple. The ambulance, we called everybody. I thought he was going to die. But that was exciting. And then it's funny. As soon as he started breathing, the music went back on. We all started having fun. Yeah,
right. Oh, you're going to live? Fine.
Oh, he's good. Yeah, I'll be all right.
John,
just give him another perk.
John, you have any drunk Mark stories that you want to tell?
I have an amazing story from years ago. I had a video of it. I had stolen a video camera.
Different story.
Wait.
Which has since gotten stolen from me with all of the most amazing footage ever in it. So we documented a whole summer in 98, the whole entire summer. Somebody had it in their hand at all times. So one of my favorite, which I would take people to show them this video. Uh-huh.
Not my proudest moment.
Wait, what? Was he naked?
No, he wasn't. But we're in Margate, and it was the night Princess Di died. And I don't know if we mentioned it before.
We didn't mention Princess Di. Sorry.
So we were out drinking, and at the time, I had ran to a guy who had Valium. And I remember I bought Valium. It was a unisex bathroom that I was never in before. And I'm like, that's cool, because there was a girl in there, too. And I'm like, this is wild.
Yeah.
And I was buying drugs, too. I'm like, this is amazing. So I was just like, it was the last weekend of the summer. I was like, end of the summer. And so I'm giving Mark these pills.
Yeah.
And he's like, you can hand something to Mark. If he's not paying attention, we'll just take it. And so I was like, Mark, take this. What is it? Don't worry about it. Okay. So
that's how much I trust Gannone, which is pretty sad.
It's fucking crazy.
So we're filming, and
I don't know this, by the way.
You don't know. And we're like following him around, actually. And a friend of ours' girlfriend comes out of the bedroom and goes, oh, my God, did you hear what just happened? We're like, no, what? Princess Di just died. We're like, what are you talking about? Princess Di just died. Just now she was in a car accident. She died. Turns to Mark. He went, good, that floozy. Right? And he goes, so everybody's, and the girl goes, like, the girl, then we go to the girl, and she
the girl
looks,
was mortified.
Yeah, mortified. And he was like, no, I don't mean that. I don't mean that. It's like, I don't mean it, but she was a floozy. So, you know, I take it back. It's a sin, but she was a floozy.
Not my fault.
So then I'm just, fault. Now I'm fixated on Mark. I'm like, give me the camera. I'm watching. People are having conversations with him. And
not even coherent.
You look at the person talking.
Forgive me, prison. I don't know what I was
and
saying.
And then you turn and look at Mark, and he's not even into it.
Like, did he tackle anybody?
No.
I was beyond past that point.
Oh, okay.
At one point,
I was catatonic.
He turns to me, and I have the camera on him, and he goes, he walks up, and he's like, Gannone, it was bad for a while, but it got better. It got real better. And I'll never forget that. It's burned into my mind. And I had it on video. A hooker's got it now, but I hope she's using it. Yeah.
She did steal it. I hope she made money. I hope she made some money on it.
I hope they bring it out every year. Like, this is the anniversary when I got that Hawkeyes. I got that Hawkeyes video. We got to watch it.
I think you knew Princess Di.
Well, she was a floozy.
He had a very
But
that makes Mark sense where she got the Eagles jacket from.
Mark wasn't a drug person, but he was easily influenced person.
Yeah.
Well, how about I'll never forget the first time he calls me on the phone, like, we got to be early 20s. He's like, yeah, you want to do acid? And I'm like, I don't know. He's like, why? You think? He's like, yeah, I think we should do it. I'm like, all right. I said, I'll be over in like an hour. So I don't know what my perceptions of acid are, what it was. I never even knew. I don't know what acid is. I don't know what it looks like. I don't know what to I come to his house, and he's got these, like, little tabs of paper. Acid.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh, my God, this is it? I'm like, yeah. And I just put it in my mouth. He's like, oh, my God, no. He's like, I wasn't ready for that. What are you doing?
I thought we were going
to
talk about it.
I thought it was something different.
He was going to talk me out of it. And be like, no, we shouldn't do this. He was like, what, this? So I went, I guess we're tripping.
Boom. Oh, we had him. Ball.
Yeah, we went up our clubhouse.
Ball.
And, we played music together. That happened.
I think we air guitared whole entire album.
So we did. No, it was the end of a song.
No, it was an album.
I do know.
It was an entire album.
I do know. He was standing on the coffee table, and he's playing the air guitar, and I'm air drumming, and it was Porch or something by...
Pearl Jam.
Pearl Jam.
Yeah, we did. I think we did 10.
And the song cut off, but we never stopped. It ended. There was still like. Like,
no, it can't end like that.
Yeah, no, there's still like 14 seconds left. There was still like total silent in the room. And just we just never stopped doing it. Yeah.
Oh.
We had nice times.
That's funny. Yeah.
Nice times. Wait, talk to me about this clubhouse. You keep talking about a clubhouse.
We got to take you, dude. It's great.
We got to take you.
Yeah, we still have it. Yeah.
You literally have a clubhouse?
It's basically,
I was there yesterday.
Picture 1,600 square feet.
Yeah.
We sectioned it off. Front room's like a frat house with a bar.
Yeah.
And we got a golf machine up there. We got a stage up out there. And the back room's got couches, TV, a lot nicer, a lot more intimate. And that's it.
It's a house?
It's a
second.
It's like a 1,600 square foot apartment studio. Okay. We sectioned it off. There's two rooms.
And then who?
But it doesn't have a shower or a kitchen or anything like that.
No, it's just for, you know.
Yeah, no, that's fine. But like, how did you obtain
out of high school? Our buddy Rocky found this place. The guy downstairs had just opened his garage business.
Yeah.
And he had this upstairs thing. I was going to help him pay his mortgage. He needed to rent it out.
Yeah.
So he rented it to us.
And you're still paying for it?
We've had it for 35 years.
Rent when they first started. So I wasn't even old enough. I was 15 when they got it.
Rent when we started was 340.
300.
Oh, yeah. And then now it's 340. And the guy loves us. He looks at it as it's his business.
Yeah.
He knows we were there after hours, late night. He's like, I always got somebody watching after my place. They're always here.
Jesus.
They're good guys. They're good guys.
But we have done some damage. Like
we have done a lot of damage. We've probably done more damage than we did help them.
They had a fish tank. I'm sorry.
Oh, my God. We had a 75-gallon fish tank. And we had a hothead buddy with us. We used to have a pool table up there. And he got mad and he threw one of them Great Bear water coolers and shattered the whole tank. And it just... flooded his place downstairs. Plus, we used to bounce on the floor when we had parties. We'd have like, we'd have like 300 people up there.
Yeah.
You would see the floor give. Like, we're going to end up in the fluorescent lights were falling off onto his customers' cars and stuff like that. Like, he put up with a lot of shit with us.
I feel like I'm glad I didn't know about this.
We had Christmas parties, Halloween parties every year for a while. Live bands play, stuff like that. It was a pretty amazing place.
Oh my God!
They're starting to build actually condos right. They're knocking down the crap around there and building these apartments and all. Yeah. But before it was just garages.
How many guys are in on it?
I would say it was about 15 of us, 12 to 15 when we first started, and there's probably about eight now. Maybe. Yeah. Well, we had friends and other people, but as far as people involved, we're like 15, and I know we were definitely at 12 because I remember at one point every guy would pay a month's rent.
We're at eight.
That was your dues. Now we're down to like eight. Yeah.
Eight of us left. Mark's not a part of the club anymore, by the way. The founding member.
Founding member.
Can't do it.
Fucking shit.
The Flyers tickets are expensive. I can't do it.
Friendship is apparently.
Oh, my God. Cheap. So now talking about this place, I got this great story for you.
Yeah.
So every year at our clubhouse
for
Christmas, it was like a thing for us. Like, we need to go cut down a tree. Like, we're not going to buy a tree. We need to cut one down. So over the years, we went to Jersey, and we went in friends' houses, neighbors' yards, and cut trees down. You know, all the wrong shit. One year, we're in Philly. We're at, like, 8th and Johnson.
Uh-huh.
And we're at this party with these girls. Next door, they got this beautiful Christmas tree in their front yard. Like, this is great. We're coming back this week. We're going to get this thing. So it was me, three buddies of mine. We had one buddy who his father was in the Navy. He lived at the Navy base. And he's like, it's like a Wednesday night. We're going back. We got our black stuff on. We're all ready. We got our two-way saws. We got this thing. You know, we pull up. We block the street off. We got this. We got this. Trees down. Gone. Bring it up the club. Thing's beautiful. We'll decorate it tomorrow. No problem. But what we didn't know is we had off the next day, and my buddy's home sleeping, and his dad comes up to him probably around 10, 11 in the morning. He's like, hey, Andy. He's like, do me a favor. He's like, what, Dad? What's up? He's like, go get me your wallet. He's like, all right, Dad. He's like, Dad, I can't find it. He's like, I know you jerk off because it's in the guy's yard whose fucking tree you cut down. So we got caught. We had to go back. We had to dig out the stump. We had to pay for the tree. We had to apologize. We had to do all the right things. You know, funny story. Makes for a funny story, right?
Turns out who...
All right. Now, let me fast forward 20 years down the line.
20 years.
At least, right? At least. Down the line, I get a phone call from my younger brother, and he's like, hey, Mark. I'm like, yeah, what's up, Mike? He's like, remember when you guys saw that tree and Andy dropped his wallet and he got caught? I'm like, yeah. He's like, where was it? I'm like, ah, right at Ethan Johnson. It was like the second, third house in. He's like, yeah. He's like, that was my wife's family. It was her. She was the little girl. When we cut down the tree, we had to go back and apologize. My brother winds up marrying her. How full circle is that?
That's fucking ridiculous.
So now I still got to hear it. After all these years, you scumbag, you had to fucking take that tree from them.
Mark, do you have any shit stories you want to tell?
Poop stories?
Yeah.
Like actual shit?
Yeah, like when you shit
yourself. Oh, yeah, I've shit myself a few times now in my day. First one was in college. I was literally...
So you jumped right into it.
You're like, you don't forget that kind of stuff because it's so embarrassing. It's so kind of uncomfortable. Like, you remember it. So, yeah, the first one was at Drexel. I was literally late for class, crossing Market Street, and I was just far gone wrong. And I was like, oh, man, go to bathroom, get rid of the underwear, get rid of the evidence, go right to class.
Yeah.
Do what you got to do.
That's what you do.
Second one wasn't as good of a story. I think I was just going to the bar or something stupid like that. But the last one was a good one. So mm-hmm. I'm at a friend's house.
Right.
They're actually customers of mine from Stokes. They invite me back to their house. They're like, oh, we're going to play pool. I'm like, all right, I'll come hang out with you. So I go to their house, and they have like this little bathroom off to the side of the kitchen, and it doesn't even have like a lock on the door. It's like one of them folding doors. So we're down in the basement playing pool, and I'm like, hey, guys, I got to go to the bathroom. I'll be right back. I go up, and I literally just had to pee, and I'm peeing, and I'm actually in the bathroom peeing, and I shit. I'm like, what the fuck?
As you're standing
I'm
up.
Like, yeah, I'm already here. Like, what the hell? So now I'm like, oh, shit. They don't lock on the door. So now I'm like, I got my hand on the door, holding the door shut because I don't want nobody to come in. The couple's in the living room. Like, I don't know if they're – I'm getting naked. I'm butt naked in their bathroom, of course. I shit. So I'm like, all right, I'm gonna rinse these underwear out. I guess I gotta just trash them. I'm just gonna go command. Nah, put them right in the trash. I mean, I cleaned them first. It's not like they still stuff. So now I'm up there for like a half hour.
Yeah.
I go back downstairs. I'm playing pool. The one kid questions me. He's like, yo, dude, what were you doing? He's like, you were up there for a while. You're all right. And I just start smirking. He sees the look on my face. He's like, what happened? I'm like, all right, this is pretty funny. I'll tell you. So I'm telling him the story of how I shit myself. And his brother and his girlfriend there, and they're there. We're having a little fun with it. And they're hysterical laughing about me telling them how I shit myself. So as they're laughing, I'm laughing. I shit myself again.
Come on.
Yes. I laughed so hard that I did it again. And as I did it, I'm cursing myself. Remember De Niro and Jackie Brown?
Yeah.
When he's coughing from smoking pot?
Yeah.
Like, I was so upset with myself because I can't believe this happened again. I'm like, really? I'm like, you got to be kidding me.
Did you tell
them? So now, they saw me do it. They're on the floor crying laughing. So now, this kid's like 230 pounds. He takes my clothes, he puts them in the washer and dryer. I got his short shorts on. He gave me his boy shorts to wear. I'm like, I guess I got to stay now. I wait for my clothes to get done. You know, I'll be the brunt of the joke. I don't care. It was funny. And then the funny part is, as I go back to Stokes, it's not even 2:00 yet. I walk in shorts, which I never wear.
Right.
And I have all these clothes folded in my hand. So when I walk in the door of Stokes, they're like, what the fuck happened, dude? And I'm like, that's for tomorrow. We'll talk about it tomorrow.
The bigger story is, have you seen a proctologist? I feel like your gate valves are starting to weaken.
Well, I mean,
it's time, buddy.
I did take care of that. So hopefully we were good.
How about a time you got caught having sex?
Well, oh, my God. Oh, God. Oh, the one. Oh. I didn't get caught, but I thought I was going to get caught, and I thought I was going to die. I meet this girl. He's working at McDaniel's. I meet this girl, and I'm not even thinking anything of it, and she's cute, and we're talking, and we're hanging out. He's talking. We're all having fun, and she's like, I got to go, and it's 2:00. I'm leaving. He's like, yeah. I'm like, listen, I'm leaving. You want me to drop you off on the way home? She's like, you don't mind? I'm like, nah, no problem. So I take her home, and I'm driving by. She's like, there's a spot. You want to come in? And I'm like, yeah, okay, cool. I come in. We're having a couple drinks. We're talking. We're having fun. Now we go upstairs. She's putting outfits on. We're having fun. I'm like, this is going to be great. So I don't know. It dawns on me at one point. I'm looking around. I'm like, wow, this is really nice house. I'm like, you live here by yourself? She's like, no, my husband and my son are down the shore. And I'm like, oh, my God. I'm like, oh, my God. So I stayed.
I mean, you didn't know.
Yeah, but the whole time I'm like, I'm on edge. I'm like, this guy's coming home with this kid tonight. I'm getting shot. What the hell?
That's fucking hysterical. Do you want to tell any John Gannone naked stories before I move on to my questions?
Oh, I've seen Gannone naked so many times. It cracks me up every time.
I look different every time. That's why. Every time I can get naked right now and then put my clothes on and get naked again, and I look totally different.
He's like the Schmo. You remember the Schmo from when we were little? He can form into whatever you want him to be. Well, it was funny because earlier I was showing him the video down at Lakes. We'll just be randomly on a 16th tee box, and he just decides to get naked and go fuck with the deer.
Then so, climb a tree.
Yeah. So, of course, I got to film it. I mean, I didn't
the
have to.
The most embarrassing thing about that video was how I couldn't pull myself up on the deer. Yeah, that's what I look at. I'm like,
you did pretty good. You're like overweight koala bear.
Thanks, buddy.
Let's set the scene for everybody on this. You're playing on a public golf course.
Public golf course,
in
yes.
Philadelphia.
Almost done, too. 16th hole. Yeah. And he just decides, listen, he don't tell me nothing. He just decides to drop everything and start walking out toward the deer. And I'm like,
the deer asked me to do it. They were like,
I did not.
No, the deer did. The deer were like,
They did look trance.
Yeah, next time, maybe you run up and grab me by the arm.
I do have the video. They did look trance.
I'm wandering into the woods nude.
Although half of them were a little upset.
But they didn't all run away.
No, they didn't.
They were disgusted.
You are right.
It was like we were talking earlier. They couldn't stop looking.
I think the other half might have been calling you. I think they welcomed you, bro. They thought you were going to be the leader in our tribe.
That's fucking ridiculous. All right,
surprised I got you back.
I'm going to ask you a couple.
I live with the male.
They still call me.
We're thriving down there since they closed the golf course. There's a statue.
Sorry, Dave.
I'm sorry. We got a tangents. I just imagine a grotto of me down the lake since they closed it down, and all the deer like worship.
They just
worship the statue
of Indiana Gannone.
Or they're like, never go by. Or they fear it.
Don't ever walk by there.
Because they didn't hang around once I was in the weed. You know, they didn't wait.
It's haunted. You can't go by there.
But they didn't run away.
So. They didn't either. I don't know, because they can beat me up. You know, like I wasn't. They weren't scared of me at all. Like most creatures are scared of humans. Like most creatures are not scared of me at all.
John, I'm gonna have to go back to the video. I want to say it was half and half. I think half ran, half stayed.
Yeah, no, right.
It was like the Howard Stern kind of thing. They're like, I want to see what he says next. You know, like the other half hung around.
I want to just. I've seen enough of Mark's pictures of you naked. Do you shave? Do you shave?
I do now.
Oh, good.
Well, I do. Actually, four times a year. I don't have to, like, because I get lucky no more. Like, I don't have to, like, impress.
Right.
But, like, holidays, I have to. I don't even know. Like, see, change of seasons. I pretty much do a lot of, like, you check your batteries, your smoke detectors on daylight savings time. I shave my bush.
Yeah, but why? Yeah. Why the
winter? How about like, your
body? Yeah, everything.
Why the winter holidays?
No.
See, it's shaved down. It's shaved down.
But
it's now winter. That I shave, I am exposing all these fucking moles and shit. Like, I don't know which is better.
You're going to fucking die.
Yeah. Oh, are you kidding me? Everything.
You're gross, man.
Things are trying to get off me as fast as they can, but they can't.
You're gross, man.
You're fucking gross, man. One time we're sitting next to each other. We're living together. Funny. It's like 94. Yeah. And I have no shirt on. I just got done work. I have jeans on. We're on the couch. And I look, and I catch him, like, looking at me, like, out of his corner of his eye. Yeah. And I went.
He's like, what are you looking at, man?
I went, what are you looking at? I went, what are you looking at? Am I fat? And he went, no, a couple moles.
Couple moles and things.
Couple moles. I went, I'm fucking gross, man. I meant it. Like, it was so sincere.
It was so sincere. We laughed for.
I portray myself like Gollum. My reflection is not kind.
But to you,
precious.
You do have beautiful eyes. You do.
You know what?
That's why the deer took him in.
It is. I am quite thirsty after the bowl. Yeah, but once I went bald, that kind of. Yeah. It was too close to my eyes for people to look at. That kind of it took from my, like, that was a big hit on my eyes.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I can be fat and sit down.
How about if Mark draws in a hairline?
Oh, the picture.
It was pretty fabulous.
That was pretty great.
That was shake hair.
Shake hair. Yeah.
It was
like that. Amazing. Like those round.
I wish we had cameras so the audience could see the picture because it was pretty funny.
Yeah. It was like the round poop peel spray on hair. Yeah. It was like that in a shake can. Crying tears as we started the first shake. We were like, wait.
Instantly after.
It's like that magnet game where you used to put the mustache. Oh, as soon as you start doing it, like, oh, my God, it doesn't look like
that. Oh, that's who you look like.
The magnet game.
Yeah. All the hair around.
Did we ever do the high school reunion story?
I don't think we did a high school reunion story.
When we lived together. Did you know we lived together?
Yeah, we did. Yeah, where's John at?
All right, yeah. We went down that road.
Okay.
So episode 10, if you would like to hear the school reunion story.
If you want to hear the John Gannone story, go back to episode 10.
We did the manger story.
I think that's in my top five of all time. We didn't get caught. It wasn't epic, but to me, I will forever crack up for that.
And Michael, if you listen to it. He has one of the funniest lines of the whole thing.
Ever.
Because they're like, oh, they stopped doing it. They're like, oh, why? Because there's two pregnant cows. two pregnant donkeys.
He went, hee-haw.
Yeah, yeah.
I was busy throwing up. I missed that story. Yeah. I missed that line.
Yeah, I guess they don't do it anymore. Like, oh, they don't do it. You said they don't do it anymore, whatever. He's like, why? They're like, because there's two pregnant donkeys.
Oh, shit. All right, so here. All right, I'm going to have some introspective questions real quick. We'll bring it back a little bit.
I'll try.
All right, what would your 18-year-old version of you think of the current version?
He'd probably be like, you pussy.
Really?
Yeah.
Why?
Yeah. I got soft, man. I lost testosterone.
We all get soft.
Yeah, I got soft. I got sensitive, all that stuff. That 18-year-old guy would beat the crap out of me.
Were you like an angry, mean guy? Like...
Not always. That didn't come until probably late 20s. Yeah.
Yeah.
I was angry at the world. But when I was I was a maniac. I just wanted to throw steak knives in the ceiling fans and jump off roofs and tackle cars or whatever.
Did you get in a lot of fights?
No, not really.
That's what I mean.
No, I liked self-abusing myself. I didn't want to hurt other people.
Yeah. Do you have any advice?
Now I want to hurt other people.
Yeah, I know that. It's funny. I know that version of you. You have any advice for the 18-year-old version of you? What would you tell yourself?
The 18-year-old version of me?
Yeah, like if you could go back and give yourself advice.
Watch out for the drinking. You got many more years.
Slow down.
Slow the hell down. I would never thought I would be drinking this much, man. I really didn't.
50 when we were 21 looked a lot different than 50.
Yeah, it's different. Okay. You know, 50 could be like 40 now. Like, yeah,
it's different.
Yeah,
I want to believe that. Style.
I would have told him, yo, calm down. You got a long way to go. It's not a sprint.
Yeah.
It's not a sprint. It's a marathon.
I don't like the word marathon, but as long as it's not a sprint,
unless it's the chocolate bar. You remember that one?
The marathon bar?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, fine. Right, John, right. John remembers every candy bar.
Stop rubbing it. Or is that second fat joke? That's two in a row? You wanted to double down on the fat joke?
Double down.
You know what? I don't remember.
Double D.
It probably sucked. You probably had fucking nougat.
You have any advice for any prospective bar customers?
Yeah, man. Stop with all these stupid drinks. You know what I mean? Like, I had a guy come in Stokes the other day and asked me for a screwdriver. That's exactly how
I said. I want
a screwdriver.
I think I was there.
I'm like, it's a fucking orange juice, you jerk off. Come on. It's not 1980.
No, it's a fucking screwdriver, dude. Yeah, I would love for somebody to order a screwdriver. If I tell that to people today to come
up. The guy had a jacket on like Fonzie. How are you supposed to take him serious? Come on.
I want to meet this. I hope he's there tonight.
I'll introduce you to him.
Please do.
But anyway. No, these people were like with their fancy stuff. Come on, dude. You're in a corner bar.
Yeah.
So can I get a Manhattan? Can I get a martini? Dry martini, little dirty. Just get the fuck out of here. You're going to get a fucking Jameson and a fucking can of Miller Lite.
You have any IPAs?
Yeah. Yeah, we got one. That's it. And it's 8.5%. It's not bad. So that's what you get.
I do like the martini at a dive. I think
I like a martini too, but
I think a dive bar can martini it also.
Can I give?
It's how you ask for it, though. You understand what I'm saying?
Gotcha, yes, sir.
Can I give you an Angry Dave story that I've never told on this podcast?
I'm excited now.
This is the first time we
get to talk to you.
Dirty martinis. I was maybe 23, 24 years old. I was in law school with some law school buddies. I was in my fancy martini stage. So I was drinking dirty martinis.
Mid-20s?
Mid-20s, yeah. Mid-20s. We go to this bar where I know the bartender. She's a good friend of my wife's. I basically drank a whole fucking bottle of martinis. I go out of there. It's the first time I ever blacked out drunk in my life.
First one?
First time.
Nice.
So I lived at 17th and Spruce.
He was so drunk, he went, I drank a bottle of martinis.
Yeah.
Guys, did you see what I did?
I drank a whole bottle of martinis.
Whole bottle of vodka. Fuck you. Oh, God.
I know we had 3 hours with them.
I hope your bare ass gets chafed tonight, you fucking...
Oh, that's happening.
Shamwell. So we're walking, apparently.
Did we get sued for that? Are we allowed to say that?
I think so. I think it's dead.
He got beat up by a hooker. Did you hear that story?
Shamwell.
Shamwell or John?
No, Shamwell guy. Oh, Shamwell guy. I was you got beat up by many hookers.
Yeah, I was with him, man.
Wait, what do you mean you were with them?
No. Yeah, we both got beat up by the same hooker. He was trying to do the tail whip. I'm like, yo, Bo, that's not working.
Yo, Bo.
Stop trying to whip him.
Shoot his mind before she
Your towel's too absorbent. The end isn't getting wet. You can't do this. We can't fight with these things.
So we're walking back.
Sorry, Dave. You should know better.
That's all right. So I drank a whole bottle of vodka. With some vermouth in it and some fucking olive juice, which would be called a martini.
Yeah, why don't you just say martini?
Sorry. Dickhead. We're walking back to my apartment, and apparently I was making fun of my law school friend. His dad, a couple years earlier, died in a horse accident, and I called his dad a pussy because he got killed by a horse. That my dad would never let a horse beat him.
That's for real. How do you? Martin picked the wrong time to go to bed. Yeah. You have some, there we go. Wow. So that is probably one of the most genius jokes I've ever heard in my life.
It's fucking disgusting.
If you say that to me, I am like, the level of that is beautiful.
And then, so I and can't. And then the next
man, it takes a certain person to tell that joke.
Some kind of asshole.
Yeah. But we're all thinking it, man.
But he didn't punch me in the face, which is amazing. But I get back into the house. I wake up the next day. Apparently, my shoes are off. My pants are off. They're still standing up. My pants were literally like half up. Like they were.
You stepped out of them and they just stood there.
Were
the shoes under them?
Yeah. My shoes were under them at the bottom. My pants were standing the fuck up. And I was fucking in the middle of the floor. I woke up.
You're a scarecrow.
And then I had to hear it. There was a guy that lived across the street from me that also went to law school with us that was not with us that heard me yell at him at the top of my lungs. Your dad's a fucking pussy. My dad would never let a horse beat him. So,
how bad did you beat yourself up after that one?
What's that?
How bad did you beat yourself up after that one?
No, he's not wrong, though.
No, you know, that was bad.
Is your dad your height? Because I don't even know. It's pretty funny. If your dad's like a short dago like my dad, funnier.
I mean, he was 5'10", but he was like
that's
wide.
A giant.
Yeah, that's giant in our world.
I used to pray to God I'd be 5'10".
Yeah, right? Me too. So that's my fucking angry
Martinis Dave. Do dirt to devil.
Oh, Dave, I'm sorry devil. To laugh at your angry stories because they're hilarious.
I'm a fucking asshole.
Yeah.
No, you're actually way better than we're doing, buddy.
No. Yeah.
Trust me. I gotta apologize every Monday morning.
There is an angry Dave story where I get in, where you have to listen to my I think my mother's podcast, Debbie, where I talk about where I got into a argument with a person with Down syndrome at a Flyers game.
Not everybody gets down.
And so it begins.
Shit happens.
If you're me, yeah, it does.
So one other question I want to ask you. Mike Lane was supposed to be here
tonight. Oh,
but he's God, he can't stop having kids. What are you gonna do?
He's
like, oh.
He's tending to the grandchildren. He's
the grandchildren, exactly.
They're actually his children.
Oh. I know.
They're not grandchildren.
Oh, my bad. Oops. Sorry, Mike.
Oh, Mike, we love you. Congratulations.
Yeah,
on your,
congratulations. On your, buddy,
on your new we miss baby. Your delivery guy. We need more Jameson.
Congratulations on your new baby. I'm sorry you're everybody, not going to see her.
All the kids in the maternity ward, we're congratulating that kid, too. $1 million baby.
Yay.
Good
for you. Take them out.
You're going to be in commercials, kid.
I'm so sorry.
You made it to the big time.
You're going to be in commercials, kid. You're going to be a star.
I'm so sorry you're not going to be able to see her when she's 25, but whatever.
He's probably be better off. He'd marry her.
Kidding me? He's got hair plugs. He's going to be all tan, white teeth.
His daughter.
A flying Mercedes.
His daughter will have her first baby. The baby and her, him will be in diapers.
Grandpa Lane.
Who's your great-grandfather? No, it's just my dad.
No, he's going to have another kid, and then his kid's going to have a kid. And he's going to have a kid.
When I finally own a house, that's where I want to live, Grandpa Lane.
Too expensive. You can't live there.
I'll work for him.
Smells like onions.
And breakfast pizza.
Oh, my God, the best.
So enough of making fun of Mikey Lane.
Well, we gave him the 10 minutes.
By the way, it's not enough, but we can
stop. No.
You said 10 minutes. That was only 5.
No, we're going to go more. What is it like to be a bartender for Mikey Lane?
Oh, you know what?
By the way, greatest experience of my life.
No, guess what? Mikey is just, he's loud, obnoxious, but he's nowhere near as bad as half of the people I wait on.
Oh, God. Don't.
Nah, nice I mean, he's just. He I mean, listen.
Well. Yes. He financially compensates.
No, he spends money. He tips well.
He can fucking stand on the bar and shit if he
he's
wants
not,
to.
He's not going to start trouble. He's loud and obnoxious.
No,
but he's not going to start trouble. And you might have to hear the same 8-10 songs on the jukebox. But other than that, it's okay. Yeah.
Back in the day, we used to have to hear him sing them.
Well, he does do that sometimes. Yeah. But he's not as bad as a lot of people.
Well, at least he has a nice voice.
He went to camp, so he can kind of hold a tune.
Yeah.
Yeah, but he gets loud.
He is loud.
Very loud.
He's loud.
He's loud. I feel like apologizing for sometimes, but he...
No.
I get it. I'm with people that I feel like... and people with me, I'm sure that feel like they should have apologized.
Well, but here's the flip side of that.
He's not hateful. Like, it's not...
It's not malicious.
It's not coming from a bad place.
No, it's not malicious.
He's trying annoying to and shit.
You know what my favorite part about hanging out with Mikey Lane is that everybody that knows him doesn't know who the fuck I am. And they all think I work for him.
Yeah, you're his lawyer.
I don't care, though. It's so great because I get to be anonymous.
It's his bodyguard. He knows judo.
Yeah. It's the greatest because nobody knows who I am. I mean, I met you guys through him, right? Like, nobody knows who I am. And most of the time in my life, I'm sort of like the center of attention. And when I'm with him, I'm just fucking in the background.
Yes.
And it's awesome. It's wonderful.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, it's wonderful. Nobody.
I don't know how to be the background guy. Unless you're around, then I have no choice.
Well, that's kind of me and Mikey's.
Yeah. Okay. Fair enough.
All right, so I got 20 questions for you.
20? Oh, whew.
All right, it's the Angry Dave podcast.
Yeah, are we going to get angry?
Yeah, what makes you angry?
Oh, people.
What about people?
Everything. I'm miserable because people suck. People never do the right thing. They're selfish and ignorant and arrogant, and they constantly piss me off.
In every part of your life? Mostly at work?
96%.
At work?
No. 96% in life.
Gannone?
Good. I just wanted to interject because I thought this would have come up.
Yeah.
Mark is angry all the time.
Really?
Sorry, the slurs. He gets to his...
Those are not words. We can try again, though.
And that's why he's angry.
And that's why.
It's like the Forrest Gump speech. And that's all I have to say about that.
That's perfect.
Take two.
You got it, buddy. You got it.
Mark allows people to disappoint him.
Yeah.
Basically, is what I'm going to say. So me too, if he expects something of someone and they don't do it, he gets disappointed. Now, which when he was younger, you know, he didn't give two shits or whatever. And now he's more of a, like, he's like disappointed by people's actions and all, and doesn't take into consideration.
Yeah.
Just like, you know, like, yeah.
I feel like I understand this because I'm the same person, right? So
yeah.
It's that you know that people know better.
Yes.
And they still act like pieces of shit.
True. And there's also a lot of logic to where I get it. Like, I'm a bartender, so my friends have surpassed and gotten married. I started hanging out with younger people. They've all gotten married and they're having kids. Now I'm hanging out with younger people. So there's that generation gap. You're going to have that problem. I get that part of it.
Yeah.
But I still have a problem dealing with it.
Yeah. No, right. But still, you know better. I mean, you know better. And just.
Well, I think I'm not a religious person, but I believe in morals. And I think people should hold a certain kind of standard. And when they don't, I get angry.
Yeah, just being like respectful to each other and each other's. Yeah,
like, you know, for example, I work soaks. I'm outside. I work during the day. I'm outside all the time having a cigarette. The number of people that walk by that make eye contact, I just say hi. And they can't even say hello back.
Dude, that's
the simplest thing in the world. I know it shouldn't make me mad, but like, you know, dude, I'm not looking to have a conversation with you. I'm just saying hello. I'm making a friendly gesture.
I know.
Like, how hard is that?
That's a very South Philly thing, by the way.
I say, about that. When I went to Atlanta with him,
and
when I first started living there, people, we'd walk down the street. We didn't have cars. We walked everywhere, go to the store and stuff.
Yeah.
People would say hi, and I was so freaked out. And I would say hi to everyone. Then while I was living there, say hi to everybody. And all. When I came back to Philly, man, I would walk down the street.
You start crying because nobody said hello back.
I mean, it was like I cursed them.
Yeah,
I would say hi. Either they would dead ignore me or give me a dirty look. Like, I stopped that instantly.
It's an all of Philly thing. I know it's a New York thing. New York people don't say hello to each other.
I think it's a city thing.
It's a city thing, maybe. But people say, I do it all the time.
I don't think it should be an anything thing. If I make eye contact with you in the street and I say hi,
it's polite. Like, it's respectful. Yeah,
and
just say hi back.
Listen, I don't.
It's not going
to
kill you.
I'm not. I'm a pleasant person to talk to. Like, when you get to know me, I'm pleasant, right?
Absolutely.
I'm not an overly friendly person. So when
I disagree with you.
When I go out of my way to say hello, I get so fucking mad when people don't say hello. I did it twice today. I remember every single time.
Sure. Yes.
And, and by the way, I'll never say hello to you again.
Yes.
You can be fucking, I won't piss on you in a fire at that point. Because you're a jerk off.
Yeah.
You're just a jerk off.
Yeah.
Anyway.
There's one kid comes every day after work outside of Stokes and waits for the bus. And I'm out there all the time. And every time. I see you every day, dude. What's up?
Right.
No, nothing.
Maybe he's wearing earbuds.
Huh?
He's wearing earbuds.
Maybe he didn't shave his bush.
Whatever. I'll slap him tomorrow.
No, you won't. You'll say hi again. You'll get rejected.
No, I'm done with it. I'm done with him.
What makes you happy?
Being by myself. Because there's
no room for me.
I like hockey and beer and James. So, J-Mo.
J-Mo.
Dave don't like J-Mo.
J-Mo. That's a fucking...
J-Mo's hot.
Some fucking millennial bullshit. Can I get a shot of J-Mo?
Nah, I consider myself a simple person, man. It don't take much for me to be happy, but people just don't get it.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah. What are you most proud of?
Oh, not a lot, buddy. Not a lot.
Why?
I don't know.
You're a good dude. Everybody likes you. No, there's nobody.
I'm proud of my morals, and I'm proud of the man I am. I think I handle things, for the most part, well. I think I'm an easy person to get along with and talk to.
Yeah.
For the most part, obviously.
Do you think you have any enemies? You have any real?
Oh, I'm sure people do not like me.
Really?
Yes.
It's hard for me
I carry a very...
Really?
People that don't know.
For as much as I say that some of the things that I said, I think I carry a miserable demeanor, and I think people are intimidated by that, and they think of me as something that I'm not.
Okay. So we probably have that in common. I call it the standing murder face.
Yeah, I have bitch face. Yeah, yeah. I have bitch face. I do.
You guys just Eiffel Towered me.
What the fuck? Oh, yeah. We did Eiffel Tower you. Thank God my dick wasn't inside of it.
Well, again, we need that camera, John. See, people don't understand what's going on.
How about if you could change one thing in your life, what would it be?
I go back, I would have been a fireman.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Talk to me about that. Why a fireman?
I just always, I don't know, I always felt, this is going to sound so weird, but I just always felt of myself to be a superhero. I always wanted to save people. Yeah. And I think it's my biggest problem today. I think I'm still trying to save people, and they don't want to be saved.
Yeah.
But I think I think that's what I always wanted to do. I wanted to have, what'd you say?
He's trying to fly.
at least you're not trying to fly.
Not yet. No, yeah, it's coming. Dementia will kick in another 5 years.
If you were a fireman, by the way, you would have been died of... at 25 in a fire, so
probably, but I would have had, you know, I would have been okay with that. I that was something
that
I always
draft
wanted to do.
Would have been about you.
Yeah. Well, you're
you go, we go.
Like no, you go.
No. No, bye. No let window
go,
love.
Let go. I would have my lighter.
Sorry, we're referencing many movies.
No, that's all right.
But that was something that I actually there's not. I think that was my biggest problem in life, is I never had many goals or one things that I wanted to do.
Yeah.
So I didn't have things to strive for. I did want to be a fireman. There was only one other thing in life that I did want to do, and that was be a play-by-play announcer.
Yeah.
But I never did anything to go forward with that.
Well, you got a great voice for it, by the way.
As far as communications. And
he was fabulous. We would play PlayStation.
Yeah.
Hockey, and he would sit and narrate, like we'd have the voice.
I would just do the game.
He would know all the guys and do it like
while they were playing,
Mike Clement and all. Yeah. Like he would do it, and I'm like, dude, like this is a talent. Right. To just be able to know that fist, speak that fist, yeah. Like do it.
So would you tell yourself?
Ask him if pot had hindered maybe any of the decisions you made growing up.
Hindered?
I don't know. I mean, being lazy. Because I feel like us smoking pot from when we were
no, I don't think 20s. So. I don't think so. I think that's just a matter of you're not getting any. If you don't know anybody, you're not getting anywhere without a communications.
But are you
background.
Getting off the couch?
Now I'm gonna go back to school and get a communications degree. When I already went for a marketing.
Sounds like what a pothead would say.
All right, fair enough. Fair.
But I mean, we know why the firemen happened because you know that's not what you know your parents really.
They
didn't.
No, they didn't want that for me. He wanted a better life for me. I'll never, you know.
Right, it's not.
I don't blame my dad for that. I mean, if anything, I feel like I let him down.
But my
dad was a fireman.
But the,
yeah. So was my uncle.
The communications or the media thing, that's not something that any of us would have known how to do.
Right.
Like a path that we would
I wouldn't have known. No, I wouldn't have known the first path. Especially when I decided that I would have liked to have done that.
Because,
like you said, you have to know what you want to do early in life so you can take the right classes and strive to what you want to do. I didn't realize that till later, and I enjoyed it that much. I mean, is it ever too late? Probably not, but
maybe
it's the pot.
Gannone just called me a pussy because I was nice to you.
No, I called you a pussy because you haven't drank your beer and it's been sitting here all night.
I'm fucking running a podcast, you jerk.
I remember last time you ran a podcast, you drank a half bottle of juice. I mean, Crown Royal.
He's doing a hell of a job.
Amazing job. He's got it all organized.
How about... one thing you would change in the world if you had the chance to? Anything. In your world, the greater world, anything.
Well, tough question.
And don't say these stupid kids. I want to start hearing positive stuff out of you. Everything's been very negative. I know it's
I'm on Angry Dave's podcast.
Oh, yeah. Oh, my God. It's so funny. What am I doing here?
What are you doing here?
Why are you here?
What are you doing? You once fucked a sheep, dude.
No, the sheep.
No, he got me.
The sheep fucked me.
He was cute. He had blue eyes.
He put me in boots so I couldn't get out. I couldn't get away. He stuck my boots in the mud.
Gotcha.
Oh, no, it wasn't me. Gotcha. It was the other way around.
You guys are idiots.
Yes, we are. What was that question?
One thing you would change about the world.
About the world?
Yeah.
Oh, man. Probably government.
Yeah.
The way things run in this world, it's just these same people running our country. Right. And as much as we have the power to vote and do things, I don't know how much we can change.
Right.
I think those people are always going to be running the country.
Yeah. The power comes in money and, yeah.
Yeah. Takes money to make money, and they're the people with the power.
Yep.
So we'll just be pawns. We'll save that for a different day.
Yeah. most impactful person in your life, who would you say most impactful to you?
I would say both of my folks. I envy them to death. I only hope to be half of the people they are.
Yeah.
Because they really are the most amazing people in the world. And the fact that they put up with me makes them even more amazing. And they just, I mean, my dad's going to be 80, mom's going to be 76. They just are still giving. They're just still giving in their life. They're awesome.
That's awesome. How about the most impactful event for you?
The most impactful event in a positive or negative way?
Either way you want, well, both. Both or whatever, however you want to define it.
I would think, I remember the most impactful event in my life was a negative one, of course. Maybe that's probably part of my problem, but I remember being on I worked at the Justice Center when I was right before Atlanta, when I was with the electricians.
Yeah.
And a 25-year-old kid fell to his death, and I was right there. Wow. And that was something that really stuck with me and really changed my perspective on life.
And how so?
Just to see how everything came about and how traumatic it was and how everybody rushed to the scene, and then this kid to fall so far and he was still breathing when I actually seen him, it just kind of hit me in a certain way where it shook me up for a long time, and it's still with me. Like sometimes you see things like that and it just doesn't go away.
Yeah. So I don't know if you guys listen to any of my podcasts, but my first one I talk about it, but. The most impactful part of my life or event of my life was the same kind of issue. My uncle committed suicide in my basement when I was 8 years old.
Okay.
And I was sleeping when it happened, but my aunt woke me up. God love her. She was, she was only in her early 20s at the time, but she woke me up to tell me. And I still can remember that. I can remember hearing my grandmother cry still to this day, really. Like,
and it's a shame that it's... Yeah. Those negative things that I think impact you more.
Yeah, yeah, a lot.
Like, they stick with you more.
They do, and it's the same kind of thing, the fragility of life and just, realizing that it can be gone in a minute and not understanding it, at least at the time.
Right, absolutely.
But, yeah, awful, awful stuff. Anything, like, real positive?
I'm sure. I'm sure.
It's not where we are these days.
Yeah, right. How about you?
I mean, I could think of simple stories. I mean, off the top of my head, like just thinking of simple stories.
Yeah.
I get offered Flyers tickets. This has got to be 15, 20 years ago.
Yeah.
And one of the stipulations of the Flyers tickets is I got to take their nephew.
Yeah.
Now, this kid's 10 years old.
Right.
And we got second row seats. Now, you're taking a 10-year-old to a hockey game. I don't really know, but we're going to get along. We're going to have fun. We both like hockey.
Right.
And I take this kid to the game, and we're there early, and there's warm-ups. And we're doing the warm-ups, and there's the photographer hole in the glass.
Yeah.
So the players are skirting around, and all the kids are hanging around waiting for a puck.
Right.
So the guy comes by, and he hands a puck through the thing, and he gives it to the kid that I'm with. And this is a 10-year-old kid, and there's a 5-year-old kid next to him. He takes the puck, and he looks at the kid, and he gives it to the kid.
That's awesome.
And I thought that was the coolest thing in the world. You know what I mean? Like, as a 10-year-old kid, you get a puck, you're excited, and he knew enough to be like, wow, this kid wants it more. Let me give it to him.
That's awesome.
And that was pretty cool. Yeah. I mean, that's on a minor scale.
Yeah.
I didn't learn that till 31. It's hard to get a puck, Bo.
It's hard to get a puck, and this kid gave it to another kid.
No. Fucking Gannone ain't giving no puck.
Selfish son
of
a
bitch. How long I waited for this puck? I want them to think of pay. You've been alive for 8 years.
Yo, kid,
I've been alive
me,
for 30 kid, give me wanting that this. Yeah, I've made way more years of want. You'll get your puck.
Gannone said, I'll steal you, bro. I'll steal you. Bring a 19.
I ain't strong, but I can still lift you.
Yeah, I'll lose.
How about your best quality? What do you think your best quality?
Oh, goddamn. I don't have
yes, you do. It's not a hard question.
That's when you're quality. Asking about yourself, it is.
It's not.
Yeah, it is. No, it is, because I like to consider myself a modest person, and I don't like to gloat and brag about myself.
Of course.
I know I ain't shit, and there's so many better people out there, and...
Maybe.
If I had a picture of quality, I guess it's just my caringness for other people.
Yeah.
I put people in front of me.
Yeah.
My life sucks, but I try to help other people because that's what gives me satisfaction.
What's your worst quality?
Oh, my anger.
Yeah.
It gets me in a lot of trouble, or it makes people, you know, think different and love me.
I actually, you know, it's funny because people say that about me, but I don't think I've ever seen you angry, really.
Well, because you're always around me when I'm drinking.
No, you get angry. I mean, he gets bitchy for like long periods of times. So it's not like he's not angry. Like, oh, I'm gonna flip out on you.
Yeah,
just looks like that resting bitch face kind of person.
Yeah,
where like, oh, don't talk to Mark. He looks like he's in a bad mood.
Okay.
So yeah. He's constantly got that bad mood.
My demeanor.
And that's why it's like, what did I do? People. Like the people around him are like, I must have did something wrong because Mark's bitchy again.
All right.
And you got 9 people feeling that way. And it was probably none of the 9.
But see, here's the thing. Here's the thing I don't understand. Like, I don't go at people. Like,
right.
All right. So what? You don't like my demeanor? Leave me alone. I'm not going
to.
I guess maybe
I have seen you that way.
Like, I've had people come up to me and be like, what's the matter? You look miserable. No, I'm fine. I don't need you asking me what the fuck's wrong. Like,
maybe they're scared that you're miserable towards them and they don't want that.
Yeah,
well, if I was miserable for them being wrong, I would tell them. I think I'm pretty good at that.
Yeah. You've told me about that.
Told me that today.
It's been a while. I've been there like, so I'm the same kind of person.
Yeah, I have a resting bitch face and people misconstrue that for you being a miserable person. No, I just... Don't feel like talking right now or don't feel like interacting.
Right.
Like for me, it happens all the time in the bar. Like
if you're there by yourself, whatever.
Even as a customer. Like I live on top of the bar.
Right.
So I come downstairs, I just want to come in and watch the game. I purposely put myself in the corner to have a drink and watch the game.
Yeah.
Everybody wants to come up to you and talk to you. I'm like, yeah, I'm bitchy. I don't want to be bothered. That's why I put myself off in the corner. I'm here. Like I'm not going to say hello, but they want to talk. And I'm like, I don't want to talk right now. I'm not in that mood. I'm here to have a drink and watch a game.
Right.
People don't get that. The minute you don't want to talk to them, you're
an asshole,
motherfucker.
Yeah.
No, you should know better.
All right. What's your favorite type of music?
Oh, I'm a folky guy.
Yeah?
Yeah, I'm a singer-songwriter type guy. I love the acoustic guitar and... I would say my roots are folky.
All right, you're going to play something for us before we end?
If I did, it wouldn't be folky. We'll probably do a freestyle song or something.
All right, that's fine.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, how about your least favorite type of music?
I don't dislike metal. I don't like the screaming.
Yeah.
I don't like that death metal where you should have something to say, not just screaming.
Right, where it means nothing.
Right. You're just screaming. Not that it don't mean nothing. Maybe it does mean something to them. I just don't get it.
Right.
That shit is not my thing.
If you were a woman for a day, what would you do?
I'd be a dirty little slut.
I hope that's true.
You'd have to be. Did you ever see Bachelor Party with Tom Hanks?
I don't want to try on clothes.
Did you ever see Bachelor Party with Tom Hanks?
Yeah.
When the girl's head's or his head's on the girl, and he's like, what are you, crazy? Look at my tits.
Yeah, it's only one thing to do. What does this thing feel like?
No, I would say if I was a girl, I would probably take advantage of people.
Sweet. Sexually?
Maybe. Anyway, I would just use what you got to get what you want.
How about if you were arrested, what would your friends and family think happened?
It'd be my fault.
Pyromania.
It would be like
road rage.
It would be like when we growing up in South Philly as kids. Okay, yeah. When you would come home and you're like, "Ma, the neighbor fucking yelling at me." What would your mother say? What'd you do? Yeah. You must have did something wrong. Right. That's would probably be the reaction if I got arrested.
Right, but what would
you did something wrong? What'd you do?
What would they think that wrong was? What would the first thing that came to their mind?
Probably something on a large scale of bombing or murder.
I said pyromania. Right.
Yeah. If I'm going to do something wrong, it's going to be worth it.
Yeah, he's like,
no, it's not going to be like a DUI.
No. It's going to be. I would be like.
I'd be shocked if I heard that, though you drive drunk, which we don't condone.
But it's
not like
we don't condone.
No, we never condone.
It's funny. He only drives drunk when he's driving someone else drunk home
for the sake of the world.
And I'll be like, they're doing something. And he don't have to, but he's a good guy. He's like, at the sake of him driving drunk, like, you're not safe or you're not trusting, whatever.
In our 20s, ask them how they all got home.
Mark drove.
The responsible drunk got them all home.
8 years, Mark was the only driver for all of us. That was. Mark drove.
We used to tailgate while Market Avenue.
Market Street.
I swear to God, I'm drinking. Not even joking. Like pop the hatchback and just start drinking right on Market
Street.
Between second and third.
Yeah.
We would go to Five Spot. Yeah. And we would just pop the trunk with a case of beer and just tailgate and pregame.
Somehow we got VIP status in this club. Yeah. And it was at the right time, it was one of the hottest places.
Bartenders love us.
Yeah. And Market at the same time. Yeah. And we're not fighters. Like, we're not going to cause a problem. Like, when we come in, we bring girls with us.
Actually, at that time,
we're not only 30 dudes.
We were like 14 deep. What kind of bartender ain't going to want that with people that don't cause a problem?
Yeah, right.
We got 14 people that are going to drink, they're going to tip, and they're not going to cause a problem. Who wouldn't want that?
Yeah, right. Yeah. How about an everyday struggle for you? Obviously not your weight, because you're a jerk off. But
showing up to work on time.
Not now. I work at night now.
Actually, you're pretty good.
I'm actually good. I'm very timely. Plus, I live upstairs, so I'm always on time. Everyday struggle.
Yeah.
Lately, it's been my body, dude. Like, I'm getting old. I hurt. Like, it's rough getting up in the morning. I need like an hour before I can. But it's the eyes, the shoulders, the knees, everything. My eyes, it's killing me. Oh, dude, I'm gonna have to start carrying readers around.
When did that happen?
Like, literally within the last 2 years.
That's what I'm. Yeah, because my eyes are literally perfect.
Came like that, dude.
Really?
Yes.
Mine started early.
Literally, was an overnight thing.
So I'm overnight.
That's what I'm scared of.
I'm 47, and it's happening within the last year. I absolutely need readers.
I can't look at my phone the first when I wrote wake
that. Up. I can't. I don't know what that's like. Because you saw me earlier. I was staring at you. You were looking at me.
Yeah, I
wrote this small fucking thing.
Is that Felix the cat?
It is Felix the cat.
Oh, my God. Wall. I love him.
Yeah. How about...
sorry.
No, you're good. How about the type of porn that you like?
Corn cream?
Corn cream. Can of corn?
Pee.
Oh, pee.
Mark's
I was with you. I was getting hungry. Everybody says that.
Mark's got a foot fetish.
I wouldn't say I have a foot fetish, but I respect a woman that has a nice foot. It can be a turn on. Like, a woman with a nice foot can be a turn on. Mm-hmm. Do I want her to put her feet around my cock and rub it? No. But a nice foot can be a turn on. So I don't think that's my fetish.
I'm sorry. So what is your fetish?
When you turn on the porn, is it group sex?
No, I'm one-on-one. One-on-one kind of guy, yeah.
Do you like the Latina, the African-American, the eye ties?
I don't think that I discriminate. I just...
you just like one-on-one.
Newest videos. Newest downloads. He just hits new videos. He's like, oh.
Whatever.
Yeah, he's like, whatever. I'm like, man.
Tranny.
Yeah. I mean, obviously, I'm a lot attracted to a little bit of a younger girl.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
I'm not a cougar guy.
Daddy.
I'm a cougar guy. Are you like a cougar or younger person?
Who, me? Oh, no, younger. Yeah.
Really?
I like younger
people. You know what? I don't have enough confidence to be with younger people. So I like cougars because I'm like, I can definitely get a cougar. Yeah, like I'll be masturbating and be like, this will never happen. I have to stop. I'm so like, I could never get this.
So
girl.
Can we recreate the deer video with a bunch of cougars out in the field? Half of them run, half of them stay.
And the other one mauls me. Yeah, I can't wait. I look delicious. Cougars aren't going to.
He does look delicious.
He can even hang from a tree.
I look like cured meat.
I'll put the green card up.
You have any weird.
Yeah, Fogo to Chow.
Fogo to Chow. They got me on a stick.
Gannone on a stick.
Do you have any weird fears?
Spiders.
Really?
Yeah, I don't never like them.
Yeah, arachnophobia.
I don't fear many things. I just don't like them. Yeah, I have arachnophobia. They freak me the fuck out. The eyes, the fucking furry
I've
shit.
I've never seen a spider eye in my life.
Got bit by one a couple times. Yeah, hurt like a motherfucker.
Favorite thing about bartending?
Favorite thing?
Yeah.
I think I was meant for it.
Yeah.
I think I'm a fucking vampire, and I as much as people joke and they think I'm a miserable motherfucker, I enjoy it.
Yeah.
I enjoy it.
Yeah, you're a good bartender. You're pleasant and
attentive.
He's attentive.
Not if you got a penis.
That's not true. I tend to be a horrible bartender when it's not busy. I like being busy. I like when I'm moving, I'm on fucking point. Like you, there'll be a half an ounce in your beer. I'll have already. I like to move. I like to be busy. I really do.
What's your least favorite thing about bartending?
Regulars.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Serving the same people day in out and day and night out. Yeah, yeah. Because I think that's the part of the job that I hate. Like I almost would love a job where it's constantly new people.
Like in an airport.
Or the stadium. Sure. Something like that. Yeah, where you're just working. You're just making drinks. You have time for a short banter, but nothing long term.
Yeah.
Because when you get to sit and you have to entertain people on a constant basis, they want too much. They are overbearing.
And they expect too much. They expect shit for free. And
well, it's not even so much that. Because if they are good customers, they'll get that.
How about your strangest place you had sex?
You know what? I've been asked this question a lot before. I always confused by it. I would have to say they were never really that weird. I like when I want to have sex, I want to be comfortable. I want to know I have time. We're secure. We're good.
Mark wasn't an alley bathroom.
No.
Sex guy. No. Spur the moment.
No.
He wasn't a whore.
No beach. Nothing like that. I don't know. Did in the car a couple times, but that was never even fun. It's like you're.
Yeah, right.
I'm a bat.
Doctor says I need to back you out of me.
So I, if I had to pick, I don't know.
I mean,
any weird ones?
Probably. You lived in the.
I did on the bread route in the back of the bread truck. Yeah,
that's crazy as shit. What are you talking about? I know. To a literal. He was a delivery man that had sex in a truck. They write movies about that.
I just remembered that.
Wow, that never happened to me. I actually banged a piece of bread though. We worked the same route.
We did. You in the bread?
It was warm, man. It was warm, and I was like, I was going through a lot of things, and I thought it would make me forget what I was going through. But then I just thought about that.
Brought your own butter
from then on.
That's what I was.
Brought your own butter.
Did you butter the bread?
No. But I had peanut butter and jelly packets that were like the ones the spaceship people take. You know those packets?
No, I don't. But
I do.
You know what I'm talking about? They had like these things. They were like space meals.
Yeah.
And peanut butter and jelly, I was taking a freeze dried them because I had all the bread I wanted. By the way, peanut butter and jelly on a long roll is like what maniacs eat. That's like what a murderer eats right before he kills seven people.
Is that why I enjoyed them so much?
I did love them. I just love bread. It's not so much.
You used to give me the packets.
We're not
I
here
love
for
them.
Me. We're here for you.
No, but I used to love when you gave me the packets.
I would give them to you. Yeah.
I would mix it up. Could be a Kaiser tonight. Could be a fucking see the long roll. I don't know.
Torpedo roll.
What do I want to put it on tonight?
Last question for my 20 questions. When it's all said and done, what do you want to be remembered for?
I just want to be remembered.
Yeah.
I just want people to be like, I remember Mark. He was a good dude. Enjoyed his company.
Yeah.
Fun to be around. Never had a bad time. Now, I know that's not true, but if I can, what I wanted them to say, I want them to say that.
Well, I never had a bad time. I mean, you sit in a corner every once in a while, but
I think I'm pretty fun.
No, you are. You're a great time. I mean, you know, we met each other like three times. You tried to tackle me twice, but whatever.
He gets a little aggressive when he's drunk. Yeah,
I am very handsy when I'm drunk. Does, yeah. I do. I get very aggressive. When I was younger, it was way worse.
Before I asked Mark to play some music, you have anything you want to talk to Mark about Mark?
No, I'm grateful to be his friend.
Did we miss any stories?
I'm sure we did.
Well, yeah. Thousands.
We'll have him back when I do mine.
You gonna do Marie with me? You can fill the parts in?
No.
Why not?
Because I can't. Now that I hear my voice,
it'd be better. You'll be like, God damn, I sound good.
Absolutely not. Everything cracked. Besides the fact that I'm gasping for air all the time, I also realize I can't hit any note other than this one.
You just got to do the drug dealer, that part.
Drug dealer.
Are you helping?
Yeah.
So, yeah, we're going to play this.
Yeah.
Well, oh, my God, you're going to have a theme song in a minute.
I don't know if I'm allowed to use it.
We'll have to call TK. I think I still have their number from Covadas. We might be able to call them.
He did.
I'll give him like $7.
Yeah, we'll change one word and they can't say nothing.
No, I was happy to be a part of this, though. We were talking about you and my goodbyes.
What's that?
What did you ask me? I don't remember. Anything else I want to say about you?
Yeah.
No, I'm so
about me?
I met him and he was so much fun. He was Gannone before Gannone. Like when I met Mark, everybody's like, he's the fun one. He's the crazy one.
Right.
And I was like, he was. Like his brother Michael, who I was friends with first. And all he wasn't.
And then a girl broke my heart and I turned into the guy from Up.
On that note, that's all.
That was fun, dude, right? Oh my God. What happened?
So much fun. Then he got mature. Know what it is?
You know what
when
I was thinking?
You get to a certain age and you're like not established. When you were your age, your father was your age, he already paid for three kids to go to college.
Right. And I'm still being a tool.
Yeah, right. And you're like, wow, I just got fucking Wick medical teeth or something. Yeah, so I get assistance. Yeah,
government gave me free cheesesteaks this week.
Shit, this week.
What happened?
Mark has a father.
No, I meant I meant to ask you what happened. One of the first times, we went, but that first summer with the cottage, I forget what happened with the window. What happened?
Yes.
All I remember is your the window falls down on his hands.
Yes.
And his hands are in the window.
Yes.
And he was so calm. And he was just like, what did you say?
I remember every part of it.
What did you say? You were just like, please help me.
Yeah.
Like the window literally slammed down on his hands.
I'm hanging out with them. They're playing drinking games. Everybody goes to bed and I'm in their cottage and I have to throw up. And I go out of the apartment. I think they're like an inside lock. Like I couldn't figure out how to open the front door. So I open their window and I'm throwing up out the window of their place. And so my Mark comes up and he's like, are you all right? Whatever. And
the window's down on his hands.
The window comes slamming down.
Slamming down.
You know, and it was those old wooden windows.
Yes.
It just comes down.
Slam.
And just slams across all four of my fingers that I have sitting there.
Dave, he went like this.
And I didn't make it. I didn't even move.
Didn't make a sound. He just looked at me with these puppy eyes, and I'm like, "Are you okay?"
I'm like, "You got to open this window."
He's like, "No."
I want to fast forward a couple of years. Is this why you thought that you could deal with a broken hand so you didn't have to go to an
Navy? You were so good. Yeah, that's exactly.
It was preemptive. Yeah,
I did.
It was ready
it was
for
across
it.
All these fingers. Nothing broke, but they were bruised across all the fingers. Yeah. Like an old wooden thing.
Episode 10.
Yes, sir.
All right, Mark, you want to play a song or two?
Yeah, we can do that.
Yeah,
we'll do that.
Well, Dave's wrap it up. This is where the credits.
We have to.
This is where the credits play.
Yeah. No. We can keep talking all night. I don't give a shit.
No, you're out of beer. I'm ready to go somewhere else. And my alarm just went
this
off.
This place is dead anyway.
My alarm just went off to take my blood pressure medicine.
Hold on a sec. I'll let you get your blood pressure medicine.
I swear to God, it's a true story. I was smart enough to take it earlier, though.
All right, I'm going to pause.
Stop lying. It's just your dick pill.
I'm going to pause and let Mark get ready here.
I will do something for the people.
Do something for the people.
For the people.
Sing us a song, buddy.
All right, this goes back to my freestyle roots. No. We're going to do it. We're going to do it. We're going to jam it.
I'm not singing.
She was fine. That girl was from the project. She had long brown hair with a body me uncompare. She had a boyfriend,
drug dealer,
but I didn't mind, cause she wanted me with me. So I had to set her free. And when I hear her name,
I swear I hear the wind blow.
Well, it drives me insane. I'll never let her go. And I start to laugh, cause I'm so afraid of crying, and I'm dying to see you once more. Maria, the most beautiful sound I ever heard.
Maria,
don't tell your boyfriend how I feel about you, cause I need you, and I gotta make you mine. I've got to make you mine. Wouldn't it be cool if we got together? I'd show you that I love you. Well, then you'd understand if he's a drug dealer.
Don't you know that
he won't last forever? Well, you need the affection of an older man. And when I hear her name,
I swear I hear the wind blow.
Say, it drives me insane. I'll never let her go.
Never let
her go. And I start to laugh, cause I'm so afraid of crying, and I'm dying to see you once more. Maria, the most beautiful sound I ever heard.
Maria,
don't tell your boyfriend how I feel about you, cause I need you, and I gotta make you mine. I've got to make you mine. Maria, the most beautiful sound I ever heard. Don't tell your boyfriend how I feel about you, cause I need you. Said I gotta make you mine. I've got to make you mine.
Whenever she's around,
my whole world starts coming round,
and I lose control.
She's the way I begin to miss her. She holds me close and I can't resist her. She kisses me on the lips, walks away and wiggles her hips, and I lose control. Gotta have that girl, she's all I am.
Don't tell her, man, I got a plan, so understand that I can never be
the kind of guy down to make you cry. So you think, you say, we're never true, and then we're wasting
time.
You fit the crime,
not say what fits the crime.
Like to say what comes around and puts you down. There's a place for us,
Maria.
Somewhere, a place for us. Together we will be until eternity, and somewhere out there. Well, tonight, in the four walls of my lonely room, I pray for your salvation and rehabilitation, and I praise the Lord above. Well, to forever give you love. Can I go to sleep and dream once more? I've got to make you mine.
Do you have auto-tune?
He was so good. I was so
fast. That was fucking awesome. That was awesome. That was awesome.
Need auto-tune.
You got another one for us?
That was exhausting. That was emotional. I don't know how artists do that.
I laughed, I cried, I peed, I pooped. I drank Harry beer. I don't know, buddy. What do you like? Give me some.
Yeah, give me the Pearl.
You know, it's funny.
Pearl Jam.
I've watched him.
You want to do a Pearl Jam?
Or
yes, he knows a lot of Pearl Jam.
At home, drawing pictures of mountaintops, with him on top,
lemon yellow sun, arms raised in a V, and the dead lay in pools of moon glow. A tiny town kept tattoo to the fact that mommy didn't care. King Jeremy, the way up, owned his world. Jeremy spoke it clear as day. And Jeremy spoke it clear as day. Picking on boy, seemed a harmless little fuck. Ooh, we unleashed the light, yeah. Nasty's teeth and mid the recess lady's breasts. How can I forget? And he hit me with a surprise left. Oh, my jaw left hurting. Oh, drive right open. Just like the day, or like the day I heard. Daddy didn't give attention. Oh, and the boy was something that mommy wouldn't wear. King Jeremy, the wicked, oh, his world. Jeremy
first guitar.
You did?
He did.
Is that right?
Yes. Proud dad moment.
Yeah, he did.
That's why I wanted him to just play for us and not me have to sing in the middle.
Oh, he's fucking dude, awesome.
I've listened to him be terrible to me.
He did. He had to go through all the band stages of like fragments of song.
Yeah,
like I think the first thing I ever learned was like.
That's exactly the first thing I ever learned.
But he would just hear that over and over again. Yeah, he's like, play something fucking
different.
And then
I'm waiting for you to start singing, and then he would change to something else. Yeah.
That's all he knew.
All right, I want at least one more.
We got to do one more? All right.
Close your eyes, and I'll kiss you. Tomorrow I'll miss you. Remember, I'll always be true. And then while I'm away, I'll ride home every day, and I'll send all my loving to you. I'll pretend that I'm kissing the lips I am missing, and hope that my dreams will come true. And then while I'm away, I'll ride home every day, and I'll send all my loving to you. All my loving I will send to you. All my loving, darling, I'll be true. So close your eyes and I'll kiss you. Tomorrow I'll miss you. Remember, I'll always be true. And then while I'm away, I'll ride home every day, and I'll send all my loving to you. Said all my loving I will send to you. All my loving, darling, I'll be true. Said all my loving, all my love, well, all my love, I'll send to you.
Was that you? I can't feel it. I can't hear the beat. I'm like, well, has he got a drum machine?
I told you he played the suckiest Beatles song.
No, it was good. I love it. I love that song.
If I wasn't so hammered, I would have did Blackbird.
Well, Blackbird's a tough song to play.
No, it's not. I'm just hammered.
So we're out of beer, so we should end this, right?
All right.
I'm joking.
No, we can end. No, we can end it.
I think we did a good session, right?
We did a good session, man. Thank you for coming.
No problem. Buddy.
Until next time, we are gonna have another podcast. You're not angry enough, though, John.
I think Angry Dave and the Miserables should get together, and
I think we got to meet at the bar, and you don't let me drink.
Don't let you drink.
Don't let me drink. Yeah.
Don't let me drink.
I'm serious. And then watch me how fucking angry I am when we get here.
Oh yeah, if you don't drink, he's very angry.
We'll get drunk.
You just get drunk and then be like, "No, he's not drinking."
Beautiful, genius,
angry podcast. Why? Are you kidding me? I'd be like, "This is the dumbest thing I've ever done." Kidding me? Mark sucks at guitar. I should have never bought it for him. Mark,
but we got to get fucking smashed.
Howard,
yeah. Oh, please don't.
Howard,
I'm already getting fucking mad.
He's already angry. Got to write River Bottom. That's beautiful. That's genius.
All right, man.
I know. I'll do it for the art.
So, what do we do for a sign off?
No, well, thank you
guys.
Hello. Gannone gonna get naked.
Thank you guys for coming.
I could do my impression of a butterball.
Give me your impression. Wait.
Do you want to say it? A butterball turkey. Is anybody gonna come down in the next 45 seconds?
No.
All right, for those at home, you're not gonna see this.
This guy is getting naked in my house.
You got a platform, Jeff.
No, I can't get up here. I'll break myself.
Nah, you got that.
Do you have an apple?
Did you ever pick up a turkey by the lake? Yeah, okay.
Does he have an apple?
I look like, but it's backwards.
What the fuck is happening right now?
Apples.
I don't think we have apples.
So much props. No fight, my bird's so small, I can't even tuck it.
You know what, Dad? We'll do a strawberry.
Strawberry in my mouth? That's getting sexy.
Yeah, well, that's okay.
It's 45 seconds. I'm doing a butterball. When I did it for you, I'd have, please.
Come on. I'll leave the bait.
I know what you're doing now, but this is turning into something more fun. No, so my look.
Oh, the hacking butter.
If you picked up a turkey by its legs, like this is what it looked like. Like my thighs are the wings. Perfect. Sideways. I exactly like a turkey.
I thought you were going to do this thing? There's a strawberry.
My balls are huge. My dick's so small. Like, it definitely could have shared.
Just so everybody knows, we're ending the Angry Day podcast with a naked man acting like a butterball turkey.
It's the most beautiful strawberry I've ever seen in my life, by the way.
It is beautiful.
All right.
Thanks for your
time. Until next time.
Dave, thanks for having
me. Dave, look like a butterball.
You look like a butterball. Say goodbye to everybody.
Thanks, guys. I love you all. Thank
butter,
you.
You look like butter bean.
Everybody should catch Mark Flocco out at the next time he decides to go and perform, because he's excellent. Say goodbye to everybody, Mark. Until next time, I'm going to let this go out. Peace. We're out.